Good evening, everybody. I think we're mostly home folks tonight, so we want to extend a welcome to every one of you. Let's go to the Lord and ask His blessing on our time of worship. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank You for the gift of being able to gather and to worship You and to enjoy the fellowship of the saints. We give You praise and honor and glory for all of it, and we thank You, Lord, for Your gracious provision to us in this area. We ask, Lord, that You would visit Your people tonight. That, Lord, You would indwell the proclamation of Your word. That, Lord, You would receive our prayers and our praise. And, Lord, that You alone would receive glory from it. In Christ's name we pray these things. Amen.
I ask you to stand with us as we sing our first song this evening. Hymn number 177, I Am Resolved. May we stand as we sing.
I am resolved no longer to linger, charmed by the world's delight. Things that are higher, things that are nobler, these have the Lord by sight. I will raise hands to Him, raise hands so glad and praise His name.
That old country church.
While the choir is coming down, I ask you to stand with us. We're going to sing our chorus, God is so good. May we stand as we sing the little chorus.
God is so good. God is so good. God is so good. He's so good to me.
While you're standing, take a few moments to greet your neighbor this evening. And you may be seated. May be seated only if you will continue to sing as good as you've been singing tonight for while you're seated. Our offertory hymn this evening is hymn number 217, Abide With Me.
Lord, with me apart.
Thank you for that choir. And also, let's turn over to Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 tonight. Galatians chapter 5, verse 22. We have been looking at the book of Galatians, and on Wednesday night we have begun a short series on the fruits of the Spirit. And in the couple of weeks I have left with you, I'd like to complete that series on the fruits of the Spirit. So tonight we're going to be in Galatians chapter 5, verse 22, as we continue to look at the fruits of the Spirit. And tonight we're going to look at the fruit of the Spirit, peace. Peace is a fruit of the indwelling Holy Spirit of God in our lives. Benjamin Franklin, many years ago, discovered that plaster, the kind of plaster that was used for walls, actually would help plants grow. And we know today that it was the calcium and the sulfur that was in the plaster that fertilized the soil and helped them grow. Well, he didn't know why it did that. He just knew that it would help them grow. And so he began to tell his neighbors that if they put plaster into their fields, that it would help their plants grow. And they argued with him and told him that was ridiculous. And it got quite heated at one point. And finally, he just dropped the whole issue and stopped saying anything about them until the next spring when it came time for him to sow his field. And he went out to his field, and using his finger, in great big letters, he wrote out, "This has been plastered." And then he sewed plaster into the letters, and then he sowed the field. And it was right next to the road, and as the field began to grow, the tallest, greenest part of the field was the part that said, "This has been plastered." It was evident to everybody. He didn't have to argue with anyone. He hadn't discussed it anymore. It was evident that he was right, that the plaster did work. It did fertilize the soil. In John chapter 15, verse 8, the Bible says that the fruit that we bear in our lives will demonstrate that we are, in fact, God's disciples. And one of the fruits that will demonstrate to the world, you don't have to argue it, you don't have to discuss it, you don't have to convince people of it. One of the fruits in our lives that will demonstrate to the world that we are followers of Jesus Christ is the fruit of peace. One of the fruits of the Spirit is the fruit of peace. In Galatians chapter 5, verse 22, "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law." Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your holy, inspired, and inerrant word. And we ask, Lord, that we would hear about your peace. And, Lord, we would also experience your peace. Lord, we ask that your holy word would just take root in our lives. And, Lord, that we would be changed and transformed by it. In Christ's name, amen. Interesting thing of the Bible is that it opens, when you begin the Bible in Genesis, it opens with mankind at perfect peace in the garden. And when you conclude the Bible in Revelation, it has mankind at perfect peace in the new heaven and the new earth with the Lord Jesus Christ. But in between the beginning of the Bible and the end of all things, there isn't a whole lot of peace. As a matter of fact, as we look around the world since Christ's coming, there have been more than 14,000 wars. And even when our country has not been at war, there has been strife and contentions and protests and crime and all sorts of things that just disturb the peace. Conflict, it is just part of living in a fallen world. It is part of the nature of our existence. But Paul tells us here in Galatians that one of the fruits of the Spirit, one of the fruits of having the indwelling of the Holy Spirit of God, which changes us and transforms us and makes us into the image of Jesus Christ, one of the fruits that we have from the Holy Spirit is peace. Now understand, when he talks about peace, we're not talking about the kind of peace that the world talks about. We're not talking about the kind of peace that the United Nations pursues or that diplomats pursue. We're talking about a peace with God. We are no longer at odds with God the Father. We are no longer at odds with the Almighty God because we have found our rest. We have found our peace. We have been reconciled to God through the shed blood of Jesus Christ on the cross. We have peace with God. And because we have peace with God, we also have dwelling in our hearts the peace of God that transcends our circumstances, that helps us be at peace even when the world around us is not. The spiritual fruit of peace, it's a trait that we share
with the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul loved to talk about the Lord as the God of peace. In 1 Thessalonians 5:23, he says, "Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely." Jesus Christ is the God of peace. He is the Lord of peace. He is the bringer of peace. Now, the Greek word that's used in our scripture for peace this evening, it means oneness. It means quietness. It means rest. It means harmony. It speaks of a wholeness. It speaks of well-being that includes both our relationship with God and being in harmony with other believers, those who have a relationship with God as well. And peace is a major theme in the Bible. It appears more than 80 times in the scriptures, and it appears at least one time in every book of the New Testament. The Bible talks about peace, and the testimony of the scriptures is that you are not going to find peace apart from a relationship with Jesus Christ, apart with a relationship with the Father through Christ. The only way you will experience true peace is if you are living in a love relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, because the source of all the world's problems, the source of all the world's unrest, the source of the lack of peace in the world is sin. And no approach that does not deal with sin will ever bring us lasting peace, either within our lives, within our hearts, with God, or between individuals, or between nations. The root of all conflict, the root of all unrest is sin. It is the lust, the greed, the selfishness, the cruelty that abides in our hearts. And no amount of discussion or negotiations is going to change the hearts of human beings. That's why, folks, I don't have a whole lot of faith. I don't have any faith in the United Nations that they're ever going to bring peace to this world. Because the United Nations ignores the root cause of all conflict and unrest in the world. Sin. Sin is the root of the lack of peace in our world. I'll give you an example of what I'm talking about. A number of years ago, when the AIDS crisis struck Africa and sub-Saharan Africa, began to see astronomical rates of AIDS infections throughout most of the continent, the United Nations formed a task force, a committee, to try to do something to stem this terrible outbreak, this crisis that was happening in Africa. And as they began to study the problem, what they found was that there was one nation, only one nation in all of Africa, that not only was not seeing an increase in AIDS, but was seeing a decrease in AIDS. It was Uganda. And so they sent the task force to Uganda. They said, "We're going to find out what they're doing, and we'll copy what they're doing, and we'll nip this thing in the bud." And they got there, and they went to Uganda, and they said, "We want you to talk to someone about what you're doing." They said, "Well, the First Lady of Uganda, the president's wife, is in charge of handling this problem. She is over this problem." So they went to talk to her, and they said, "What are you doing? What are you doing to stem the tide of AIDS in your nation?" And she said, "Well, I'm a Christian, and we are teaching and preaching Christianity, and we're teaching Christian morals and virtues to our people." The United Nations Task Force said, "We can't do that." And they packed up and they left. Millions of people dying because they cannot deal with the root of the problem. And that's true in wars and conflicts around the world as well. You know, I hope we see peace in the Middle East. I would love to see peace in the Middle East in our time, but I don't have much hope that that's ever going to happen apart from the growth of the Church of Jesus Christ. When we start converting Muslims to Christianity, we'll see peace in the Middle East. You know how to solve the problem in the Middle East? You know how to cure the conflict in the Middle East? It's not through foreign aid. It's not through sending more troops. It's not through the UN. It's not through diplomatic relations. It's through sending missionaries to convert lost people to Jesus Christ. You want to cure the conflicts around the world? Write a check to missions. That's what we need. Doesn't matter how much you spend on other issues, and foreign aid will never bring peace because money doesn't change people's hearts. All you get is better financed wars. Better education won't change people. All you get is people that are smart enough to build bigger bombs. You know, the best educated people in the world prior to World War II were the German people. And they started World War II and murdered 6 million Jews. Education only gets you a clever devil. Sinful men cannot create peace either within themselves or with other men, because sin is the source of every conflict. And as long as there's sin in the world, there will not be peace in the world. Isaiah, in Isaiah 9, verse 6, looking forward to the coming of the Messiah, he said this about the Messiah. He said, he will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Prince of Peace. When the angels came, the angels declared to the shepherds who were in the field, glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace, goodwill toward men. Now, a better translation of that is, peace to men on whom God's favor rests. Peace amongst those who have a relationship with the Lord God. Christ's disciples expected that when Christ came, when the Messiah came, that he would bring peace to the world, that he would reconcile all the peoples of the world. And when Christ came, he did not do what they expected him to do. You see, Christ came to reconcile us to God. He came to bring peace in our hearts. He came to reconcile those who are believers in Jesus Christ amongst themselves. But folks, let me tell you, Jesus himself said that the world is going to hate you when you believe in Christ. Don't expect to have peace with a lost and dying world. The Bible says that you are the scent of death to those who are perishing. So don't expect to be at peace with them. Jesus himself said, do not think I came to bring peace on earth. I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set a man against his father, a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. And a man's enemies will be those in his own household. Why? Because the world will hate you because they first hated Christ. Peace cannot exist where sin remains. Isaiah 48:22 says that there is no peace for the wicked. And folks, as believers in Jesus Christ, we stand against unrighteousness. And that will not win friends in this world. You cannot bring peace to the world, though, by being just like the world. You're not going to change the world by being like the world. Jesus said we were to be salt and light, that we were to influence the world for Jesus Christ. But most of all, the Christian recognizes that the world needs a heart transplant. The world needs to be changed. People need to be transformed. And we are the only ones who have the truth. We're the only ones who see that truth. And when we have peace with God, we will have peace in our hearts as well. That means that we have joy that transcends our circumstances. We trust in God to be in control. We trust in him to ultimately reward us for our faithfulness. Whether it's in this life or in the next, we know that one day we will be with Christ and we will enjoy all the blessings that heaven has to offer. So we can face everything, even death itself, with hope and confidence and tranquility and, yes, peace. John 14:27, Jesus said, peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. John MacArthur said this. He said, peace is knowing that we may get to the point where we can do nothing else, but that our all-powerful God has no such limit. We may get to the end of ourselves. We may get to the end of our influence and our ability and our skill and our wisdom and our talent and all that we can do, but God has no limits, and that brings peace. That brings peace. The fruit of the Spirit means that we have peace with the Father, we have peace that dwells in our heart, and it means that we cultivate peace in the world around us. Ultimately, as I said, conflict comes from sin. It comes from a desire to serve our own self-interests. When two people or two nations are in conflict, it's always because one of them is selfish. But the Christian is different. The Christian has a higher purpose. He has a different objective than his own self-interest. As Christian, we're interested in the glory of God, not in our own glory. We're not motivated by self-interest because we know our Lord is going to take care of us. We have a different mission in this world. What's our mission? 2 Corinthians 5:18. Now all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ, and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses to them, and has committed to us the word of reconciliation. God has given us a ministry. He's given us a purpose. He's given us a goal to reconcile the whole world to God by preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's our purpose. That's our reason for existing. That's why we're here. Not our own self-interest, not self-promotion, not any desires for selfishness, but only to see all mankind reconciled to Almighty God. Folks, what would a church look like? What would a church look like that was wholly focused on reconciling the world to God? Not on any self-interest, not on anybody's agendas, not on glorifying any person, but only solely on reconciling lost people to Jesus Christ. What would that church look like? It'd be different than most churches I know. It'd be different than most churches in the world today. Practically, that means that we live differently. Then we make an effort to live peaceably with others. Matthew chapter 5, verse 23 says, "Therefore, if you bring your gift before the altar, and there rememberest thou that thy brother hath aught against thee, leave there thy gift before the altar. First, go and be reconciled to your brother. Then come and give your gift." Romans chapter 12, verse 18. Paul says, "If it is possible, as much as it depends on you, live peaceably with all men. Beloved, do not avenge yourselves, but rather give place to wrath. For it is written, 'Vengeance is mine, I will repay,' says the Lord. Therefore, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him a drink. For in so doing, you will heap coals of fire on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good." So for Christ's sake, we take control of our actions. We prefer to be wronged rather than to promote our own rights. We're going to control our attitude. We're going to recognize that we are not due anything in this world but wrath, that God does not owe us anything, world does not owe us anything. We're going to control our actions around others. Why? Because we want to promote the gospel. We want to get a hearing for the gospel. We want to get a hearing for Jesus Christ. We want to represent our God to the world in the best possible way. And we're going to control our actions. We're going to control our attitudes. And most of all, we're going to control our tongue, which is probably the hardest thing of all to control. I can tell you, folks, I have a brother who is he's very quiet. My twin brother, he just doesn't talk a lot. He's always been very quiet. I, on the other hand, have always been the loud mouth in the family. And it's always been a lot harder for me to control my mouth, control my tongue, because things just slip out, you know. Especially when I was younger. I'm better at it than I am now. When I was young, if it went through my head, it came out my mouth. I've gotten better about that. But the tongue is hard to control. You know, it's in a wet, slippery place, and it slips out. We need to control our tongue. We need to make sure that we aren't hurting the gospel and hurting our witness and hurting our testimony in the world. You know, the world says that you prevent conflicts, that you solve conflicts by talking. You know, the Bible says that quite often the way you prevent conflict is just by shutting up. James chapter 1, verse 19 says, "So then, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath." Hold your tongue. And I know that's hard. Hold your tongue. Hold your fingers from the keyboard. I saw a cartoon the other day. I thought it was just about me is what it was about. It probably doesn't impact any of you, but it sounded a lot like me. There's a woman in another room. She calls to her husband, and she says, "You need to come to dinner. Dinner's ready." And he says, "Wait just a minute. Somebody on the internet's wrong." So I get unfriended a lot on the internet. We need to be careful about speaking. Careful about what we say. Careful about what is going to injure the gospel. Because quite often, when we open our mouths, we just pour gas on the fire. Martin Lloyd-Jones said this. He said, if you have to, organize for war or organize for peace. But whatever else you do, just stop talking. Now, as I said earlier, that doesn't mean that we seek peace at any price. We don't compromise the gospel. We speak truth. We preach it boldly, but we preach it lovingly. And that's the really hard part. We contend for the faith, but we're not contentious. We disagree, but we're not disagreeable. We confront others, but we don't abuse them. Matthew 5:9, Jesus said, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God." A peacemaker is someone who speaks a word of truth in love. In love. That's really the point. Love undergirds everything else. All the other fruits of the Spirit are undergirded by love. Colossians 4:6. Paul says, "Let your speech always be with grace." Grace should be in your speech. "Seasoned with salt, that you may know how you ought to answer each one." Seek to be a peacemaker. When you can, don't cause contention. I read a story about Abraham Lincoln back when he was a lawyer on the wilderness, when everything was growing up out west. And he was this backwoods lawyer. And he had a man came to him one day, and he was really upset, and he said, "I need to sue my neighbor for $2.50. Abraham Lincoln said, $2.50, that's worth about $70 today. Okay? $2.50, he said, "It's going to cost you $10 in legal fees." The man said, "I don't care, I want to sue it." So Abraham Lincoln said, "All right, give me the $10 in legal fees." The man gave him $10. Abraham Lincoln went to the defendant, gave him $5, said, "Give the other guy $2.50 and apologize, and you can keep the other $2.50. He did it, and everybody was happy. Now, folks, if Abraham Lincoln can be a peacemaker, you can too. We need to seek to be peacemakers in the world, because we are working for the King and not for ourselves. And that means when we look at those who are lost in sin, who are abusive and vile and debased, we don't react like the world reacts. We see them as captives to the system of this world, blinded by sin and Satan, and we look at them with compassion and with pity rather than with hatred. I read about a man who was arrested in a New York City police raid on a loft apartment in one of the worst parts of town. They went in and raided this loft, and they found people just derelicts of every kind, people who were addicted to all kinds of drugs, alcoholics, people with untreated mental illnesses, every kind of derelict you can imagine in this loft. And they found a number of them with drugs on them, and so they arrested them and the man who owned the loft. They took them back and they booked them, and they found out something very interesting. They found out that the man who owned the loft was actually a man by the name of Sergeant Cram, who was a millionaire with a Princeton education. And apparently, he would allow anybody that had need to come to this loft, and he would give them shelter, and he would allow them to sleep there, and he would feed them and care for them. And when asked why he would live like that, he said that he did not trust the government or those who were working in these areas to really care for people. And he just felt it was a calling. It was the calling in his life to care for those who didn't have anybody else to care for them. Now, at his arraignment, he was released. He wasn't charged. He wasn't thrown in jail or punished in any way. He was only told that he needed to keep drug addicts out of his loft. Folks, as Christians, we have a calling too. The reason for our living. We're entrusted with a ministry. Excuse me. To be peacemakers between God and man. And as a result of that ministry, we are to be peacemakers between men as well. We're charged with bringing peace between God and man, bringing peace to the hearts of lost people, and also in reconciling the world. Quite often people will tell me that I look like my father when he was younger. We share a family resemblance. But you know something? We never look more like our Father in heaven than when we are ministering peace to a lost world. Do you have the peace that comes from being reconciled to God? I love the perspective of Helen Keller. She said, "I do not want the peace which passes understanding. I want the understanding of God which brings peace." That's what you need. Understand that Christ died so that your sins could be forgiven and so that you could have the peace that comes from God and a peace that transcends your circumstances. That's what Christ died to bring you. And it's that kind of peace that we're called to minister to a lost world. If you don't know Christ your Savior, I'm going to be down here at the front. During the time of invitation, I'm going to invite you to come down and say, Pastor, I want to know about this peace, how I can have it, and I'll pray with you and show you. If you are a believer in Jesus Christ, just remember, your job is to minister peace to a lost world. That's your job. Not to defend your rights, not to correct everybody's errors, not to be the smartest person in the room. Minister peace to a lost world. Everything should be measured by that. Are my actions helping people come to know Christ or pushing them farther away? That's what we need to ask. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love and compassion. We thank you for the fact that you have given us the ministry of peace. It is a privilege to minister peace to a lost and dying world. We ask, Lord, that we would be a church that was known for ministering peace. We ask, Lord, that we would love others. We would care for them. We would have compassion for those who are lost. And, Lord, that we would bring the gospel of peace to a lost and dying world. In Jesus' name we pray.